Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Well, I'm going to talk about, not about sex, but about the ambiguities of the missionary position, literally. In 1762, Denis Diderot penned a characteristically anti-religious parable. Its protagonist was the victim of some monstrous injustice who lived alone in a cave, plotting vengeance on the human race. Oh, if it were only possible, he thought, to fill their heads with some vast fantasy that would become more important to them than their very lives and about which they would find it impossible ever to agree. Upon the instant, he rushed out of the cave, crying, "God, God." Innumerable echoes took up his words on every side. "God, God." This terrifying name was carried from one pole to the other and heard in all parts of the globe with consternation. At first, men threw themselves upon the ground in fear. Then they rose to their feet, questioned one another, fell to arguing, grew bitter, began to curse one another, hate one another, cut one another's throats. And the deadly wish of our misanthropist was fulfilled. Diderot's parable illustrates, I think, two key points. The first is that religion is a perennial source of conflict, whether between faiths, Muslim versus Hindu or Christian versus Jew, or within faiths, Sunni versus Shia, or Catholic versus Protestant. Second, but related to the first point, religion is protean in its capacity to change its shape and its nature. No faith is homogeneous. All are fissiparous, volatile, equivocal, even self-contradictory, as typified by Christ's twin pronouncements. Blessed are the peacemakers, and I come not to send peace, but the sword. Thus, the Christian message, as enshrined in the New Testament, which offers Delphic scope for interpretation, could mean all things to all men. Crusaders and quietists, inquisitors and heretics, reactionaries and revolutionaries, liberals and conservatives, all have found their vindication in the scriptures. As William Blake wrote in his poem, The Everlasting Gospel, "The vision of Christ that thou dost see is my vision's greatest enemy. Thine loves the same world that mine hates. Thy heaven doors are my hell gates. Both read the Bible day and night, but thou readst black where I read white." From the start, imperial history offers myriad examples of antithetical policies justified by Holy Writ. Thus, those engaged in the 18th century slave trade asserted that Africans were descendants of Ham, blackened by his sin, cursed by God, and destined for bondage. But the evangelical revival helped to promote a moral revolution. It was personified by John Newton, Cooper's friend, the slave captain who became an Anglican clergyman and the author of Amazing Grace, among other hymns. In the 1760s, Newton thought that being a slave trader was a genteel and creditable way of life. During the 1770s, he was haunted by doubts. By the 1780s, he shuddered at the fiendish enterprise, wished to wipe out the stain it had left on our national character, and converted William Wilberforce to the abolitionist cause. Various forces were at work to bring that cause to fruition, but perhaps the most powerful was a growing Anglican belief, long held by Quakers and Baptists, and preached by John Wesley, that Africans were men and brothers with souls to save, as much in need as white original sinners of the redeeming blood of Christ. The foreign missions, which largely stemmed from the evangelical revival, were, of course, based on Christ's injunction to the disciples, "Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature." Yet although Christianity was an imperial religion whose adherents were convinced that they had a monopoly of divine grace and theological truth and a duty to convert the heathen in their blindness who were bowing down to wood and stone, it both endorsed and challenged the British imperial enterprise. And its effects were equally paradoxical. So that's the ambiguities of the missionary position. Many British missionaries were colonists for Christ, sustaining the empire of their monarch as well as preaching the kingdom of God. Thomas Middleton, who became the first bishop of Calcutta in 1813, with a diocese stretching from St. Helena to Sydney, is commemorated by a huge marble tableau in St. Paul's Cathedral, which represents him blessing two young kneeling Indians, an icon of empire-building Anglicanism. When the Reverend Samuel Marsden first brought the glad tidings to the Maoris in 1814, He spoke under the shadow of the Union Jack, and very soon they had cause to suspect that ideological subjugation was a prelude to territorial expropriation. Or as one anti-colonial spokesman famously put it, first they had the Bible and we had the land, now we have the Bible and they have the land. Like the natives of other colonized countries, Maoris feared that the missionaries' ultimate purpose was not so much to justify their exploitation as to sanctify their extinction. No one dramatized the British missionary enterprise more vividly than David Livingstone, who considered that three elements were required to fulfill the glorious task of bringing light to the dark continent: Christianity, commerce, and colonization. The Bible, trade, and the flag. Here was a new Trinity, a new article of Victorian faith, a new Athanasianism. The extent to which the evangelist was the spiritual arm of the civil power would be demonstrated at the manse in Blantyre, the settlement in what is now Malawi, named after Livingstone's Scottish birthplace, where several sewing machines were kept busy producing Union Jacks to present to local chiefs. By 1900, there were 10,000 British missionaries in the field, most part of the fabric of imperialism, intent on painting or keeping the map red. Lord Rosebery, who was briefly Liberal Prime Minister in the mid-1890s, kept cheerful by humming Rule Britannia, characteristically maintained that the empire was human and yet not wholly human, for the most heedless and cynical must see the finger of the divine. In settler colonies during the 20th century, there often seemed little distinction between missionaries and other Europeans. Lay and clerical whites learnt Swahili in East Africa from a handbook issued by the Society for the Propagation of the Gospel, which, according to Elspeth Huxley, contains such sentences as, "The idle slaves are scratching themselves, and six drunken Europeans have killed the cook." Shades of Ratus Assembly there. Some Anglican missionaries accepted the colour bar and endorsed the imposition of compulsory labour in colonies, such as Rhodesia and Kenya, where blacks often became so dispirited by white power that they abandoned their own spirits and adopted the creed of their conquerors. Like other Europeans, missionaries were not above sexually exploiting colonized people. Richard Meinertshagen said that the Roman Catholic white fathers that he met in East Africa were not white, but were almost undoubtedly fathers. On the other hand, Christian imperialism frequently proved a contradiction in terms. Many missionaries dedicated themselves to the protection as well as the salvation of colonized people, striving to improve their earthly lot while directing their steps towards heaven. They did much to make the British Empire an instrument of progress and civilization. In Africa, they opposed slavery and human sacrifice. In India, they tried to eradicate thuggee, sati, and infanticide. When Charles Darwin visited New Zealand in 1835, he declared that the lesson of the missionary is the enchanter's wand, conjuring up literacy, scientific knowledge, technical skills, and humane values. Darwin thought that Christian evangelists were good men working for a good cause, and he suspected that those who abused and sneered at missionaries have generally been such as were not very anxious to find the natives moral and intelligent beings. Certainly, missionaries did much valuable medical work and provided the schools which educated elites, native elites, among them many nationalist leaders, though throughout the empire. Missionaries, in their turn, were sometimes influenced by their charges. For example, Bishop Colenso of Natal, who under persistent Zulu questioning adopted unorthodox views about the Pentateuch and was subsequently known by the nickname Pen. And missionaries often resisted other whites who tried to fleece their flocks, still more those who might attempt to abuse or slaughter them. Serving God as well as mammon, they were increasingly open to democratic ideas and often deeply subversive to the colonizing enterprise. So those are the two sides then of the argument. From India to the West Indies, there were many imperial voices raised against the admission of missionaries on the grounds that they upset the local order, not only by condemning the unchristian behavior of the empire builders, but by their zeal in attacking idolatry. Proselytizing was indeed provocative. In India, Hindus and Muslims feared that, as one put it, "You English have taken the whole country and now you want the people to receive your religion." Thus, it was standard government policy, often ignored by enthusiasts, to adopt a system of universal toleration and to yield to the local habits and religious prejudices of the several sects which compose our native army. Failure to heed these prejudices was one of the prime causes of the Indian Mutiny, so-called, which prompted cries for vengeance, particularly shrill among the clerics. This traumatic event reinforced the conviction among British officials that laissez-faire was the best policy in religious matters, particularly as the British Empire became the greatest Mohammedan power on earth, ruling over half the world's Muslims. In any case, the Church of England was latitudinarian, as well as Erastian. It was the embodiment of state-controlled compromise and moderation. It was Laodicean, lukewarm, averse to bigotry and sectarianism. It extended from broad to high, from high to broad to low, embracing both Protestantism and Catholicism. It included Pelagians, Arminians, and Predestinarians. It even included Christians. Many Anglicans had reservations about overseas evangelism. It smacked of proletarian fanaticism. As Sidney Smith famously said, if a tinker is a devout man, he infallibly sets off for the East. Lord Salisbury denounced missionaries as vulgar radicals who might propagate dangerous notions about equal rights for all God's children. Anyway, he thought, Africans were indelibly daubed with superstition. Salisbury was cynically amused to hear that the ailing emperor of Ethiopia, fed pages of the Bible by his doctors, had expired eating the Book of Kings. Winston Churchill disliked Christian missions, as I said yesterday, describing them as attempts to annoy the heathen. It was better to leave them alone, and many colonial officials agreed, reckoning that the pristine savage was spoilt by Christian instruction, and that the warrior who had eaten his man as a quasi-religious act was a far more estimable person than the town-bred, mission-educated native. Christian missions had ambiguous effects. As Richard Burton and others observed, they fatally undermined local cultures. In New Zealand, the prescription of polygamy impaired male prestige and female security. The ban on cannibalism caused a protein deficiency in their diet, though in truth, Maoris found European flesh too salty for their taste. More seriously, the erosion of such core beliefs as mana, which is superstitious, supernatural agency, and tapu or taboo, weakened the foundations of their way of life. In Africa, where Burton thought Islam better suited to the needs of the people, who were invariably demoralized by intercourse with the white man, as he put it, and when he said intercourse, he meant it, Christian missionaries cut at the root of tribal systems based on fetishes, witchcraft, polygamy, and divine kinship. They attacked polygyny, that's more than one spouse, which united families, ancestor worship, which cemented communities, initiation ceremonies, which educated youths, and other creative conventions. Dancing was especially condemned as a mixture of Bruegel and Bedlam. Chinua Achebe's best-known novel was a lament on the disintegration of his hero's clan. White men put a knife on things that held us together, and we have fallen apart. On the other hand, converts in the developing world acquired the intellectual tools provided by a global religion to face the changes and challenges of the modern age. The gospel excited millennial hopes and expectations. Many missionaries preached liberty, equality, and fraternity, a message entirely compatible with self-determination from Kampala to Canton. The day before he died in 1925, Sun Yat-sen declared, "I am a Christian. God sent me to fight evil for my people. Jesus was a revolutionist, so am I." Converts in the developing world acquired Western political and economic aspirations. Religious propaganda introduced them to potent means of expression. Churches and schools gave them new organizational skills. Christianity often complemented rather than contradicted new nationalism in Africa, Asia, and Latin America. And it was native Christians in the mid-20th century, when the outside missionary impulse was waning and colonial empires, Britain's among them, were collapsing, who were chiefly responsible for the mass conversions, which increased the number of believers in, for example, sub-Saharan Africa from 9% in 1910 to 63% in 2010. Ironically, at the very moment when historians were accusing missionaries and empire builders of being hand in glove, the developing world was turning to Christianity as never before. In terms of adherence, the The whole axis of this religion underwent a historic shift, moving south and east. In the process, it clashed with rival creeds, notably militant Islam, once again fulfilling the wish of Diderot's misanthropist. But that's another story. Thank you.